This is a video on Edexcel Topic 2 Chemistry, C2 on ionic compounds and analysis. So, if we get cracking straight away, we've got two types of bonding that we need to talk about. Topic 2 is about ionic bonding, Topic 3 is about covalent. So let's get straight away stuck into ionic bonding. So atoms of different elements can combine to make compounds by the formation of new chemical bonds. So bonds will need to be made. This is known as bonding. Two main types you need to know about ionic and covalent. So let's get into ionic. So it's formed by the transfer of electrons. That's such a key phrase, the transfer of electrons. So ionic bonds are the transfer of electrons. They produce something called cations and anions. So ions are charged atoms, so they're produced when you lose or gain, when an atom loses or gains electrons, essentially. So cations are positive, anions are negative. An ionic bond, the cation and ion attract to form an electrostatic bond. An example of an ionic bonding compound, of an ionic bonding compound is salt. So salt is sodium chloride, so it gets stuck into sodium chloride over here. Got the element for here. So most atoms would be stable if they'd full out a shell of electrons. To become stable, they transfer electrons. That's that process that we're talking about right now, transferring of electrons. Okay, so when this transfer happens, generally it's the metal losing one or more electrons and a non-metal gaining one or more electrons. So sodium's in group one, it's a metal, okay. It is one electron in its highest energy level, because it's got one electron here at its highest energy level. So when this electron's lost, so it's going to go across. Let me get my pen so I can draw this clearly. Okay, so when this electron is lost, sodium Na is formed. So this electron essentially goes from here and joins onto whatever it's combining with. So if this one goes, you can see it's made a sodium ion. Okay. Chlorine is in group 7. It needs one. So this one that this has lost is going to be dropping in over here to make a chlorine ion. So chlorine is going to gain that electron that sodium has lost. So that's going to make sodium plus 1, because it's lost one electron. That'll make chlorine minus 1, or minus, because it's gained an electron. So these two ions now attract each other and they form ionic bond. Similarly with magnesium oxide, so magnesium's got 2 in its outer shell, so it loses these 2, they wander off, so it becomes plus 2. The oxygen, well, it needs 2, it needs 2 in its outer shell, so 2 come into this, therefore it ends up having a charge of minus 2 when it gets full because it's gained those 2 electrons. Okay, so that's ionic bonding, the losing and gaining of electrons. Remember, the amount of electrons that it loses or gains affects the overall charge. So these ionic compounds, they have something called a lattice structure. So what that means is they have this regular arrangement of ions. So it's a regular arrangement of ions, and they're held together by these strong ionic forces. Okay, these strong electrostatic forces. So they have a high melting point because of these strong forces. A large amount of energy is required to break these bonds. So that's why they have a high melting point. They can conduct electricity because they have ions, but they have to be in an aqueous state. So in other words, dissolved in water. Or they need to be molten, so they need to be melted. This is because this will allow the ions to be free to move. So let's actually talk about naming some of these compounds. So this table is a table of ions. This is given to you in the exam. We can use it to find out the formula of some ionic compounds. So when the charges of ions in an ionic compound needs balance, so you need to have the same charge on each side. Okay, so if you knew a compound contained lithium and it's a carbonate, you could use a table of ions to determine its formula. So lithium, let's find lithium here. So it's plus, just 1, so it says plus. And carbonate, that's a minus 2. So you're going to need to get 2 pluses to cancel out that carbonate. So it'll be Li2 and CO3. Let's just do another one as an example. Say you had barium oxide. Barium is plus 2, oxide is minus 2, so therefore they cancel out, so it's BaO. Say you had lead, not lead, let's go with silver Nitrate, that's plus one. Nitrate is minus one. So they just cancel each other out. So AgNO3. Let's say I had potassium carbonate. Potassium is plus one. Carbonate is minus two. Okay. So this could be K2CO2. You can need two potassiums to cancel out the two carbon. Your minus two, your carbonate. So solubility. So we talked about some ionic compounds being aqueous, okay? So being able to dissolve in an aqueous solution. So solubility is about that ability to dissolve in water. If it's insoluble, if it doesn't dissolve in water, it's soluble if it does dissolve in water. So there's some rules for solubility that you need to know. These you need to memorize. So just go away and learn these. Sorry, let's get the right tool up. There we go. Just please make sure you go away and learn these, okay? So the first one, all common sodium, potassium, and ammonium salts are soluble. So if it's sodium, potassium, or ammonium salt, okay, they're soluble. Nitrates are soluble as well. Chlorides are soluble, apart from silver or lead. Sulfates are soluble, apart from lead, barium, and calcium. Carbonates and hydroxides are insoluble, except for sodium, potassium, and ammonium. I did say you had to learn these. I just clocked as I was saying, as I was working my way through that. Quite often they're given to you and you need to apply the rules to a situation. But just make sure that you are able to apply the solubility rules. It's only 1 or 2 marks, hopefully no more than that, but you need to be able to explain these rules and use these rules. So if you make an insoluble salt, you need to perform a precipitation reaction. In a precipitation reaction, a solid insoluble salt is formed. Okay, so you make a solid insoluble salt in a precipitation reaction. If the solution of potassium chloride, of sodium chloride and lead nitrate are mixed together, the precipitate of lead chloride is formed. So it says common chlorides are soluble, except silver and lead. So it's lead chloride, insoluble. This can then be tipped off and filtered through a beaker. So you tip it off and you filter it into a beaker. Distilled water can be spilled around in the original beaker to ensure all of the precipitate is out. Precipitate will then remain on the filter paper, can be scraped away, and you're left with the filtrate. Remember, the solubility rules help you to predict when a precipitate will be formed, because if it's insoluble, the precipitates could be formed. You need to use the ion table and the naming rules to decide on the compound formed, and then the solubility rules to determine whether an insoluble salt is formed. So you need to use the rules. If an insoluble salt is formed, then there's a precipitate. Straightforward as that. You might be asked about barium meals and ion tests. So barium sulfate is an insoluble salt. Okay, it can be formed when the precipitation reaction happens between barium nitrate and potassium sulfate. That's how you make it, barium nitrate and potassium sulfate. So to make a pure dry sample of it, which is required for a barium meal, I'll go through one of those in a second, the barium sulfate precipitate will need to be washed and then distilled and left to dry on paper. So barium meal is when barium sulfate is consumed by a patient before an x-ray. Barium sulfate is opaque to x-rays, so it will show up when the patient has an x-ray. Okay, so you can see where the barium is actually gone, because it's blocked the x-rays. It allows for blockages to be found within the gut. Barium sulfate can be safely drunk, and as it is insoluble, can't be absorbed by the bloodstream. Even though barium salts are toxic, because it's insoluble, it cannot actually pass into the bloodstream. It just passes straight through the body. So we can test for certain ions as well. So metals are placed in the flame, and they turn the flame a characteristic color. So this is the science behind fireworks. So sodium ions are yellowy orange. Potassium ions are lilac flame. Calcium ions are brick red. Copper ions are the blue-green flame. Flame tests also work with compounds, not just the pure elements. So you can have a salt of sodium, and that will allow it to go yellowy orange. Now remember, you need to know the test for some other substances as well. So test for carbonates is to test to see whether CO2 is released when you react it with a dilute acid. So remember, the gas should be bubbled through lime water. If the lime water goes from colorless to milky or cloudy, then CO2 is present. Test for sulfate is to add dilute hydrochloric acid followed by barium chloride. You do need to know that test there. If you get a white precipitate, it was a sulfate. Test for chlorides is to add dilute nitric acid followed by silver nitrate. Again, if you get a white precipitate, the original compound was a chloride. Spectroscopy is just a type of flame test. Okay, it's used to detect the presence of very small amounts of elements. It can lead to discovery of new elements as well, including rubidium and cesium. Spectroscopy is fast and it's reliable, and it uses the light emitted from heated samples. And that's the end of topic 2, Edexcel C2 chemistry.